trust in God. I know He cares for me. All mountains move upon the stormy sea. Trust in God. He lives, He reigns. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds my future. My life is worth the living just because you live. Father, because you live, we declare we can face tomorrow. Because you live, we cannot live in fear of viruses and bacteria. Because you live, our body, our soul, and our spirit is secure. And because you live, not in the way that I've prepared to say it, but in the way and the exact way that you've prepared to communicate it unto your people, let our destinies burst forth with 12 wells. And let them produce unimaginable, ceaseless testimonies of manifestations in Jesus' name.
Amen.
We take authority over you, Satan, concerning today's service. And we ask, Lord, that you have the way in our midst.
Amen.
And bless our heart.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Say, I believe and confess.
I believe and confess.
As I'll be taught the word of God today, say, my mind,
you'll be fruitful.
Say, my spirit,
you'll be alive.
You'll be alert. Come on, say,
my understanding,
you produce result. Say, my body this morning,
you'll be in health.
I'll be changed.
I'll be transformed.
I'll not be the same again.
In
Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Just quick seven things. I'm going to be saying some points. So I'm going to talk about seven things now. I'm going to talk about another 12 things. And finally, I'm going to talk about 12 wells. Are you ready for the points?
Yes.
Now, the first seven things that we keep emphasizing is this, that when you come to a service, and any kind of service, God told us in this church that there are three types of people that comes to church. He says there are those who come to church to hear the word, but after the service, they don't get to remember that word. Number two, they hear the word, they remember it after the service, but they don't use it. As you have a lot of faithless people in our streets. So, if you don't remember and use it, you cannot have a testimony. Number three, we have the third categories of persons that come to our service and to any service at all. They hear that word. They remember it after the service on Monday, on Tuesday, on perhaps on Saturday, before even the next Sunday. They use it. They are definitely going to produce testimonies, not in full capacity, every one of them, but in grace of 30 or 60 or 100 fold. Why? Because each of us has three things. Say after me, capacity to receive.
Capacity to retain
what you have received, and capacity to release in using it. In standing against the devil and contrary circumstances that comes your way, I had this, God said this, I believe it, you cannot come my way. Number four, don't forget that the faintest ink is sharper than the human brain. We got some of our messages on YouTube, you can watch them again. But if you're in the service, just like you attend seminars and webinars and conferences and you go for lectures, jot things down and refer to it later. It's arrogance to come into God's presence and to think that you're going to remember all of it without having a note. Remain focused and expectant. Expectations remain the raw material for a miracle. If you don't have an expectation, There is a possibility you get out of a service and the Lord will not have visited you. Number six, your attitude in the service is contagious and you may be acting for demons or strange spirit. Finally, this is the best. This is the best. This is the best. Lift up your hands and worship God for our organist that we prayed for last week, because we know the power of God has touched him. We are having testimonies already. And you know, I remember him because this is one of his favorite words that he normally tells me. One word from God is all you need in a service to turn your life around. Clap your hands and celebrate God. Praise the name of the Lord. Now, before I talk about 12 destiny wells. In other words, for your destiny to thrive and to blossom and to manifest and to have all the testimonies that you are trusting God for, it needs to have 12 wells. I'm going to show you why 12 wells. And this is Stone Revelation Part 3. I don't know how long we're going to go, but I can see that we're going up to 6 or 7. So we've had Part 1, it's on YouTube. Part 2 is on YouTube. And this is Stone Revelation Part 3. But then, as I sat down on my table after praying and meditating and gathering my points for weeks unending, the Lord suddenly reminded me of my wife's teaching last year. And it looked strange. So I quickly remembered that she preached on 12 destiny enemies of a child. Maybe we'll get to find out from her why she preached on 12 destiny enemies. Why will a child have 12 enemies? Actually, in reading through our outline again, I have to go look for our outline. And then in reading through our outline, I actually discover that the first enemy of a man is the enemy of a child. And that when the enemy is attacking a child, it's not just attacking a child, it's attacking the destiny of a child. If you see a young girl of 4 years old that is molested sexually, no, the devil is not just attacking the body of that child, it's attacking the destiny of that child. And so quickly, the Lord just said, okay, put those points there and let's quickly have a refresher course. That as we look at 12 destiny wells that God is going to cause to flow through your destiny to manifest, don't forget 12 destiny enemies of a child. Number one, the first one she said, I won't read the scriptures, you can write it down, is contrary circumstances to the conception of a child. Well, we all know that it's in the news that it's no more a crime to commit abortion in New Zealand. But I believe, according to the scripture, that there are no illegitimate children, we only have illegitimate parents. If you are not ready to have a child, don't have a child. But for as long as a child is on his way to the world, he becomes a soul in the sight of God. And you see that a lot of people's destiny are actually destroyed or tampered with when they have contrary circumstances to their conception. Perhaps the girl is still in school and she got pregnant. And you feel most children that come in that way experience rejection all their life. I don't want to preach a message. So you have unwanted parents, some children want a male and they get a female, and so they don't accept it, the timing, and then divorce also affects a child. Number two, enemy of a child is unbelief. With a spoken word that bad the child. Sometimes people that surround the child will be speaking negative things, and it can shape the destiny of a child. Number three, she said, was lawful decrees. Lawful decrees. Lawful decrees. People that have spiritual and physical authority over a child can say things into the life of that child and will affect the way that child is thinking and will affect the way that child will live. Number 14, she said, is batting difficulties. This is spiritual. Most cases, when a woman experiences difficulty in giving birth, it can affect the destiny of a child. It's a spiritual thing. I don't want to emphasize on that for this service. Number five, stargazers are enemies of a child. Sometimes they can see. Do you know there's an exchange by demonic people? They can change people's destiny. So stargazers are enemies of a child. And if they know that something good is coming, if they know that somebody has a great glory or great star, they can truncate it like Herod wanted to do to Jesus. King's jealousy or king's decree. That is jealousy of people like teachers or classmates or peer mates. Temptation by Satan and the world is an enemy to a child. Well, you may not be there for the child, but just give the child access to 24 hours online. You are shaping the child's destiny. And you find out why a lot of children's mindset about sex are deformed. It was the internet that informed them. That's the truth. Misunderstanding of the path or gifting of our child or purpose also is an enemy. If you make your child to study law when she wants to study medicine, when God wants her to study medicine, you have actually tampered with the destiny of that child. Number 9, traditions are from Pharisees, which stifle the spirit and kills innovation. Finally, location. Location. Everybody say location.
Location.
You don't force a location on anybody. Because there's a location where God has allocated for every man. And if you're in a wrong location, may you change it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Wrong church, wrong jobs, wrong city can affect a man. Lies, denial, false judgment is also a destiny enemy, she said. And betrayal by threat is a destiny enemy. Now, why are we talking about 12? Let's look at Joshua chapter 4 once again. So why 12? Joshua chapter 4, quickly. Joshua chapter 4. Are you there? Let's just go to verse 15. Joshua chapter 4. And the Lord spake unto Joshua, saying, command the priests that bear the ark of the testimony that they come out of Jordan. Joshua therefore commanded the priests, saying, come ye out of Jordan. Go on. And it came to pass, when the priests that bear the ark of the covenant were come out of Jordan, that the soul of the priests were lifted up unto the dry land, that the waters of Jordan turned unto their place and flowed and overflowed the banks as before. Praise the name of the Lord. Verse 19. And the people came out of Jordan on the 10th day of the first month and encamped in Gilgal. Praise the name of the Lord. Go back to verse 4. 12. Okay? Go back to verse 12 quickly. And the children of Reuben and the children of Gad and half the tribe of Ben passed over hand before the children of Israel as Moses spake unto them. Verse 13. About 40 people prepared for war before the Lord unto battle to the plain of Jericho. On that day, the Lord magnified Joshua in the sight of all the people. Now let's paraphrase to verse 20 quickly. Now when they came out, back up, the Lord told them that, look, take 12 stones. And this is what you're going to do with the 12 stones. Let's read together. And those 12 stones which they took out of Jordan did Joshua pitch in Gilgal. Praise the name of the Lord. And he says, I spake unto the children of Israel, saying, when your children shall ask their father in time to come, saying, what mean these stones? So the stones is because of children. The stones that God told Joshua to take is connected to children. So if you have a preacher that is led to talk about 12 enemies of a child, then we have a good reference point. And if you see me talking about 12 destiny wells, then we have a good point as well. I'm very sure now that when I did Stone Revelation Part 1, I gave some of us an assignment and you have forgotten it. I talked about the symbol of one. One is what? God. One is what? God. Two means what? Three means what? You forgot it. Five means grace. I won't refer to it. Go and watch Stone Revelation verse. And I give you an answer. I said, what is the significance of 11? I never said 11. I just went to 12. Now, I'm going to tell you, I know you didn't do the assignment. What is the significance of 11? May you not have 11 in your life, you know, in a prophetic way. You understand me now? May you not have 11 things. May you not have 11 wells in your life. May you have 12.
Amen.
I'm going to show you why you need to have 12. Why the number 11 is not a good number. The number 11 actually means, are you with me? I said, are you with me?
Yes, sir.
The number 11 is a dangerous number. Very often it is represented as a symbol of imperfection, judgment, and disorder. Also, number 11 may symbolize a lack of organization and chaos. Sometimes it is even considered that 11 can be a symbol of sin and evil that exists among the people. But naturally, why number 11? Why number 12? Because in the scripture, look at it. Why did God give Jacob 11 sons? He gave him 12 sons. When the apostles, when the tribes of Israel were to be formed, 12 tribes. Even the parallel alternative to Isaac, who? Ishmael had 12 princes. Are you with me? Are you following? When Jesus Christ was to choose his disciples, how many did he have? 12 disciples. Praise the name of the Lord. And even the apostles, how many apostles did we eventually have? 12 apostles. When the new Jerusalem is going to come, as it was shown to us in perspective in Revelation chapter 21, how many gates are done and is it going to have? 12 gates. That tells you one thing, that there's something special about number 12. May your destinies be garnished with 12 wells.
Amen.
I said, may your destiny be founded upon 12 foundations.
Amen.
Praise the name of the Lord. Why? Because 12 is a very good number. Praise the name of the Lord. Even do you notice that when Jesus Christ, I still want to show you more about 12. When Jesus Christ multiplied bread and fish, and the boy was going home, how many baskets were left? 12 baskets. When Solomon became rich, are you following me? He appointed 12 officers that made sure that 12 months in a year. Why? How many months do we have in a year? 12 months. 12 is significant. He appointed 12 officers that made sure that for each month of the 12 months of the year, they made provision for him. That was why he was a rich man. Praise the name of the Lord. Come on, say 12.
12.
I said, come on, say 12.
12.
Come on, say 12.
12.
I said, come on, say 12.
12.
12 is the number of government. Praise the name of the Lord. 12 is the number of dominion, of order. Praise the name of the Lord. May your destiny be garnished with wells. 12. Look at Exodus chapter 15, verse 27. Exodus 15, 27. Quickly. Exodus 15, 27. Are you there?
Yes.
Now read where, this is where I'm taking my wells from. Let's read it together, church. And they came to Eli, where 12 wells of water and 70 palm trees, and they encamped there by the waters. So as I meditate upon this, I didn't premeditate. It's not theology. This is revelation. This is prophetic. As I begin to meditate on this scripture, the Lord suddenly woke up my spirit and showed me that a man's destiny must be camped around 12 wells. So I can't say by theology that I'm teaching you 12 wells as a reference point in scripture. But as I meditate upon this scripture, in reference to stone revelation that we are doing, the Lord just suddenly told me that your destiny, my destiny, should camp around 12 wells. So I said, God, what are those wells? Well, there was a block. And I felt, well, I'll just ignore it. I won't teach it if I don't have a revelation. But during the week, I began to receive those 12 wells. So I'm going to share them with you today. And by the time I finish those 12 wells, find out and ask me a question. Which of them doesn't your destiny need? But do you notice that when you have 12 wells, it produces 70. Not 7. See, can you imagine your destiny, you know, being fed with 12 wells and producing 70 testimonies? There are minor testimonies that can happen to a man's destiny. But imagine your life having 70 major testimonies because of these 12 wells that I'm talking about. You can't be a local man again. You can't be a local woman again. Your name will be heard far and wide. So I want you to stretch forth your hands in faith and say, Father,
Father,
I connect myself to this revelation. Let my destiny and the destiny of my children burst forth with these wells. Open your mouth and just pray it. Let my destiny and the destiny of my children break forth with this testimony, with these wells, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, in Jesus' name we pray. I won't bore you, I will run through it. 12. We've said it, and there's no need to emphasize, but what about wells? Wells originates things. Don't forget that. Wells originate things. Well does not only originate things, well rejuvenate things. Look at Psalm 1, verse 1 to 3. Maybe I'm the only one that won't find. Psalm 1 verse 1 to 3. Quickly. It says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. Conditions, qualifications for verse 3. Let's look at further. Another condition for verse 3 is this. If you find a man that has his delight in the law of the Lord, if you don't love the Bible, you are not qualifying yourself for verse 3. If you don't love to read the Bible, you are not qualifying yourself for verse 3. And it says, in that law is meditating day and night. You see, taking a portion of the scripture in the morning before you go out and praying is important. We call it quiet time, devotion. Taking a portion of the scripture in the evenings before you sleep is important as well. We call it night devotion. There is no way you can be equipped with the word of God in the morning and equipped with the word of God in the evening and wake up the following morning depressed. Praise the name of the Lord. Now that says, when you see that man that is like that, look at verse 3. Everybody, let's read it together. It says, and he shall be. Each time the Bible uses he, you know it's talking about she as well. So come on, if you are she, say she. If you are he, say he. And I shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. So when a man's destiny is close to rejuvenating, originating wells of prophetic sources, it cannot fail. What are those 12 destiny wells? The first destiny well, the Lord said I should tell you, is the well of purpose. See a man whose destiny is fed by the well of purpose. As a matter of fact, if you don't know where you are going in life, you are a failure before you start. You see a group of guys that say, we want to play soccer, and they've got no goalpost. How will they know when they score? That's how a man or a woman that lives life without purpose is. So the Lord said, I should tell you that your destiny must be fed with the well of purpose. Why am I alive? Why am I in this place? Why am I existing? What is my assignment to the world? A man's destiny must be fed with a well of purpose. That's why Jeremiah chapter 29 verse 1 says, 11 says, for I know the thoughts that I think towards you. That word defined in scripture as the thought that God thinks towards you is called purpose. But you don't know it by Google. You don't know it by going to school. You can't know the thought of God towards you by going to school. You know the thought of God towards you by going to God to reveal his thought towards you. What have you planned for my future? So that's why he says, for I know the thoughts that I think towards you, the thought of peace and not of evil, to give you expected end, a hope in the future. Number two, well, it's very strange to believe, but have you noticed in scripture, every man that becomes rich has something that precedes their prosperity, peace. And I've discovered that peace is the first stage to experiencing prosperity. Do you know that David went to conquer and conquer and conquer? But his son who was the richest man in the world, had peace. In other words, he couldn't have secured or protected or enjoyed that well without peace. Are you with me? So God said, I should tell you that the second destiny wealth that you must have in life is peace. Your destiny must experience peace. Look at 1 Samuel chapter 12 and see the characteristics of this churlish man. He had peace, and that was why he was rich. 1 Samuel chapter 25 verse 1, quickly. We just read it quickly. He says, and Samuel died, and all Israel were gathered together. Verse 2. He says in verse 2, quickly. And there was a man in Moab whose possessions were in Carmel. And the man was very great, and he had 3,000 sheep and 1,000 goats. And he was shearing his sheep in Carmel. Now the name of the man was Nabal, and the name of his wife Abigail. And she was a woman of good understanding. But the man was churlish and evil. Look at verse 4. Why? And David had in wilderness that Nabal did share his sheep. Look at what David said to him. And David said to 10 young men, he said, David said unto young men, get you up to Carmel and go to Nabal and greet him in my name. And thus shall he say to him that liveth in prosperity. Hallelujah. Amen. Why is he living in prosperity? He said, peace be to you. Peace be to your house and peace to all that you have. Say to the person next to you, say peace to you. Peace to your house. And peace to all that you have. In other words, peace in you, peace in your house, and peace around what you have. Peace plus peace plus peace is equal to prosperity. That is peace with you, peace in your house, peace in your marriage, plus peace around your possession is equal to prosperity. The man forgot and thought it was a joke that he had peace with what he had. And he rejected the request of David. Go and read the rest of the story. And David reminded him and said, you never knew that you have peace with what you have because I'm protecting what you have. You are not hearing me. He said, I am the one that have been protecting what you have. I am the one that is making what you have to have peace. May what you have peace. Amen. That is what is called prosperity. So the Lord said, I should let you know that destinies that experiences peace experiences prosperity. Number three. God said the third well that your destiny must be fed with is the presence of God. And I won't emphasize it. You see, Esther was to die, but the presence of God was with her. Praise the name of the Lord. Go and read Joseph in Genesis 39. He says, and the Lord was with Joseph and made all that he did to succeed. Can failure come around the presence of God? Can failure show up where God's presence is? Has been church, can failure show up where God's presence is? If God's presence goes into an interview with you, can failure show up? If God's presence goes into an exam with you, can failure show up? Hallelujah. I was writing my MBA exam so many years ago. And there was a course that people were failing. I'm an accountant and I'm doing an MBA in an economic environment. And they gave us all this mathematical capsule about economics. And so many formulas I have to put in my brain. And I didn't really enjoy the exam. But I was tackling a question and I can't remember the formula. And I know, if I can't remember the formula, I know that I'm going to fail that course. I just had a feeling right inside the exam that I'm going to fail this course. I said, God, I have read the formula, but I've forgotten. I'm telling you life testimony. And you will know why I said this is life testimony. I said, God, he said, if you have called me, I was a pastor then. I said, if you have called me, please let me remember this formula. Within 5 minutes, the formula came back to me. I could put it down in my question paper. And I applied it to the question, and I did the question, and I get out. Most of my friends, go and find out what I'm talking about. It was University of Ibadan, the MBA class. Some people, executives, will drop out of that MBA class because of that course. I have friends that we live together that failed that course, that have to carry over that course. Guess what I scored? 40. Are you with me? Clap your hands if you want to clap your hands. So if I didn't remember that formula, it was a valley of failure for me. But the presence of God showed up in my brain. And I remember.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
May the presence of God go with your destiny.
Amen.
Raise up your hand and receive it. Say, I receive your presence from today in my upon my destiny in the name of Jesus. Number four. God said, I should tell you, your destiny also must be fed with the presence, with the wealth of precious promises. Look at it. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 to 4. I'm not talking about promises, casual promises. You know, I do it. I'm not an angel. Sometimes I am so tired in the dead of the night, my sister. And because I have a desire to always put a scripture in my mind, I'm trying to meditate on one verse of the scripture, and my heart is half closing. My wife knows what I'm talking about. But I'll still read that scripture and still go to sleep. Those scriptures are not precious promises, I know. But I just read it to fulfill my righteousness. But there are times that I will just be reading a scripture and I won't be able to leave one verse. And that verse will become a precious promise unto me. Praise the name of the Lord. Let's look at it. According as his divine power, I've given unto your destiny, not just the church. Let's read it together. According as his divine power, I've given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that hath called us unto glory and virtue. Verse 4. Church, read it with me. Whereby I give unto me your destiny, exceeding great and precious promises. There's a promise that was great, that was precious, that has been programmed for your academics. Get it? At the point when you will need to marry, there's a great and precious promise that has been positioned for you to have. Get it? At the point when you are going to need a job, there's a great and precious promise that God has positioned for you. Get it? Your destiny must be camped around great and precious promises. Number five. God said your destiny must be camped around prophetic covering or protection from God. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 20. You must have a prophetic covering. It's important. That's what we are doing this morning. Look at this. And they rose up early in the morning and went forth unto the wilderness of Tekoa. And as they went forth, Jehoshaphat stood and said, he stood in those days and said, and it has not changed, it has not expired. Hear me, O you Judah, and hear me, you inhabitants of Jerusalem. Believe in the Lord your God, so shall he be established. Believe his prophets, so shall he prosper. Don't believe what you read on Google more than your pastor or your prophet. If you actually believe that God has sent this man to you as your prophet, believe what he's telling you. And that's what is going to make your life to prosper. You need prophetic covering and protection from God. Number six. God said your destiny needs pastoral care. Jeremiah chapter 3 verse 15. And Ephesians chapter 4 verse 11 says, God has given to us. He says, and I will give you pastors according to my heart, which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding. There is difference between knowledge and understanding. Knowledge is theory. Understanding is revelation. Knowledge can come from the head of the pastor, but understanding comes from the mind of God to you. And he can be using him to give it to you. Ephesians chapter 4 verse 11 says, and God has given to us what? Some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and pastors. What I'm telling you is this. If you are not called to be a pastor, you have to be pastored. Clap your hands and celebrate God. You can't be a believer in self-isolation after the virus is gone. Get a church. Get a pastor. Praise the name of the Lord. Somebody is hearing me online. Number seven. Well, that your destiny must be camped around is practice of faith. Why? In Daniel chapter 4, we're told that the king had a dream. And when the king had that dream, he told all the astrologers and the magicians, said, come on, tell me the meaning. Nobody could tell the king the meaning. And said, I'm going to kill all of you. Say, where is this guy called Daniel? I'm going to kill you too. If you don't tell me, Daniel said, he knew at that point that he needs to manifest faith. If I call you, you don't understand what I'm talking about. You don't understand. She's that queen, stand up. I'm going to use her. See, she studied something related to biology. Am I right? Are you a microbiologist? You are a microbiologist. Those are the people that are supposed to give us a solution to the virus. Look at that very well. Those are the people. And then just imagine that the president of this country or the president of the country where she comes from says, come around, I learned that you're a very good microbiologist. I'm giving you 24 hours to tell us, give us the vaccine for the virus or I will kill you. Is that not what happened? Is that not what Daniel said? The first thing is that you're supposed to be afraid. Daniel said, please, keep calm. The God of heaven, whom I serve, will show you the secret. And he got home that night. He said, my friend, if I come around. He said, my friend, real one, come around. And he says, we're going to use one thing to pray, mercy. I'm telling you what happened in Daniel chapter 4. So they prayed and said, God, because of mercy, show us the secret. And overnight, he saw the secret. He saw the dream of the king. May God show you the secret that somebody is looking to pay for. May God show you the secret that somebody is willing to pay anything for. Practical demonstration concerning your destiny. And they gathered against him and said, okay, because of those giftings, because there's an excellent spirit in you, we're going to kill you. He had to manifest faith too and tell himself, when they threw him into the lion's den, Daniel, if the lion eat Daniel, lion has consumed his destiny. You are not hearing me. If those lions had hit Daniel, those lions have not only eaten Daniel, they have ate his destiny. Speak to yourself, say in the name of Jesus. Lions, you cannot eat my destiny. You need to have faith. Joblessness, you cannot eat my destiny. Impossibilities, you cannot eat my destiny. Praise the name of the Lord. So, God said, I should tell you that your destiny must be constantly camped around the well of practice of faith. Number eight. Now, God said, I should tell you that your destiny must be constantly camped around the well of purity. Why? Look at Hebrews chapter 1, not Exodus. Hebrews chapter 1. This is a destiny secret. Read it with me, church. Some people don't know that this is a destiny secret. It says, thou hast loved righteousness. And number 2, hate iniquity. You see, holiness is a function of two things. There is no way you can love righteousness if you don't hate iniquity. So it's because you hate iniquity, you will love righteousness. He said, as a result of these two things, he said, I'm going to do this. I will anoint you with a well of gladness above your fellows. Is he talking about just ordinary things? It's connected to destiny. Why are people sad? Why are people depressed? Because you feel your classmates are well ahead of you. The same classmates that are well ahead of you, God says, if you love righteousness and hate iniquity, I will put an oil. Nobody will see that oil, but they will keep looking at you 10 steps ahead of them. Destiny testimony. Praise the name of the Lord. Do you know I was telling myself this week? I said, I just made up my mind. I said, Lord, when the rapture takes place, how many of you believe in the rapture here? When the rapture takes place, don't you think that this media, the world has already prepared the media to cover the rapture? With this virus, the way they give us updates every hour, that's how they'll be giving people updates after the rapture is happening and I'm gone. See, what if this is the last warning of God for this generation? What if God is calling the mind of everybody back to Him? What if God is telling you, because of this virus, prepare for the rapture? What if God is telling people that drop your sin, live in righteousness? What if God is telling people that are not born again and say, get born again now, it is time? What if God is calling the whole? The whole world cannot die. Except the God factor is no more alive. Holiness is one way by which you can must camp your destiny for you to succeed. Number, I love this, 9. God said your destiny must be camped around the power of God. The power of God. I don't doubt it. I went to Helim Church, a prophetic service. Somebody invited me there. And the minister there A beautiful, anointed Kiwi lady stood in front of me that she has never met me before. And she said, she didn't call me pastor. She said, I saw a warrior. She's got prophetic gifts. She said, I saw a warrior behind you as I'm praying for you. I laughed inside of me. She said, actually, this woman does not know me. So that's good. She said, the warrior has dangerous weapons. She said, I will have cast out the warrior, but the Holy Spirit told me is your guiding angel. I laughed. I've had that several times from prophets. In fact, one person told me, he said, the angel that is walking around you looks like you. I'm not afraid because I know there's a warrior that is dangerous to strike virus when it comes near me. Clap your hands and celebrate God. Not only for me, but for you that is a child of God. There's an angel going around. There's an angel walking with you, not just the pastor. I'm not saying it to blow my ego. I'm saying it so that you too know that if you are living in not in sin and you're a child of God, there's an angel going around with you. Clap your hands and celebrate. Look at it. Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 18 says, thou shalt remember the Lord thy God. For it is he that giveth your destiny power to get well. Hallelujah. Number 10. God said, your destiny must become around my provision. Genesis chapter 22, verse 7 to 18. The covenant, everyone say covenant JJ. It's not JJ Okubja. I coded it, and I want you to put it in your memory for the rest of your life. Say the covenant of JJ. You know it, my sister. Jehovah Jireh. Come on, say, I established the covenant of JJ upon my life. You know, Abraham's son, Isaac, asked him and said, here is the wood, here is the fire, here is the rope, here is everything. Where is the lamb? He asked for the lamb when there was no lamb. He never knew it was the lamb. And his father replied him and said, God himself shall provide a lamb. And as he took his hand to cut off his boy's neck, the angel of God stopped him and said, stop, Abraham! Don't touch that boy. And then he says, don't worry, I provided myself a lamb. And by the time the angel finished speaking, the angel read the scripture. Go and read the scripture. The angel didn't say, look to your left, leave to your right. The angel just finished saying what he wanted to say by stopping him from killing Isaac. And he went. And the Bible says, the next place that Abraham would look was where the provision is. You are not hearing me. May God direct your mind prophetically that places where you will look to is where you will get the job.
Amen.
The day you will click on that application, something will tell you your job has arrived.
Amen.
Something will tell you your destiny is about to unfold.
Amen.
When you see that opportunity, something will tell you your finances is about to change.
Amen.
Jehovah. Come on, say the covenant of JJ.
Of
Jehovah Jireh. Must it be on your destiny? The covenant of JJ. Hallelujah. Number 11. God says your destiny must be camped around the covenant, the well of promotion. 75 verse 6 of Psalms tells us, it doesn't matter what people believe. It doesn't matter how many connections people have. Listen, promotion, when it comes to a man, does not come from the east, nor come from the west, nor from the south. Verse 7. But God is the judge. He's the one that promotes people. And I pray for your destiny that the promotion that your destiny is already right for, you will get it. So, your destiny must be camped around the well of promotion. Always walk around with the consciousness that God is the one that will promote me. And is about to promote me. Lastly, God said, it's not going to be rosy every time. So let your destiny be camped around the well of praise. Praise. Why do I say praise? I will do my exposition and then I will close. Why do I say praise? I said praise because in Acts of the Apostles, you only need to read the scriptures before you understand the reason why some things happen. So I went to do my research and I discovered that Paul the Apostle went on 4 missionary journeys. How many, church?
4.
Go and read the whole of the Acts of the Apostles. His missionary journey was 4. And it spread throughout the span of his life of ministry. So I'm talking about so many years. So there were 4 major missionary outreach. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 13, he was ordained to be a missionary. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 16, his destiny was arrested. He was just on his first missionary journey. Are you getting it now? So imagine that just like one of the apostles was killed in chapter 12, Paul also was killed in chapter 16. The other 3 missionary journeys that were inside of Paul's destiny would never have been built. 75% of his ministry exploit would never have been done if he had been killed in Acts of the Apostles chapter 16. Because he was just on his first missionary journey. But what bailed out his destiny from that hold up? Praise. What bailed out, what caused a deliverance of his destiny from that hold up? Praise. I was just at midnight. When he felt that this was my destiny being held up, not just physically in a prison, but spiritually in a prison, he began to praise God. And the foundations of the prison shook. And not that Paul was set free, his destiny was set free. Sometimes your life and your destiny seems as if it's edged around. Please, don't blame God. Praise God. Clap your hands and celebrate God. Let's rise up. And that's why the first thing you're going to do this morning as we close is to begin to praise God for your destiny. Just worship God for your destiny. The first thing that I want you to trust God for is the well of praise. Worship God for your destiny. If you are watching us online as well, worship God for your destiny. Worship God for your destiny. Lima Shindelehe. Idego Sundalahai. Rabba Shindele. Worship God for your destiny. Lima Sandalaba Shindelehe. Worship God for your destiny. 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 Say, my destiny is still alive. Destiny has no respect to age. At age 80, Caleb possessed the land filled with giants. Worship God for your destiny. Irrespective of how young or how old you are. Say, I will still fulfill my destiny. Lord, I worship you because I will still fulfill my destiny. I'm not giving up yet. I'm going to manifest. Worship God. Worship God. Lord, I'm still going to fulfill my destiny. It's a communication between you and God. Just communicate with God. Talk to God. I will still fulfill my destiny. I'm not giving up yet. 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 Can we have the worshipers? Let's just worship God a little bit before we pray. I will worship you forever. Praise you forever. Because Jesus is too good.
I will worship you forever.
Worship you, God, because of our destinies.
I am you forever. I will worship you forever.
Translated into physical experience in your, I'm talking about if you face me, that would be the left side of your chest. And the Lord is making me to know that pain that is happening to you in the left side of your chest physically is because there's an underneath emotional pain that is happening to you. But I'm going to pray with you. One thing you will know that God is going to take care of that emotional pain is that physical pain on the left side of your chest in specific will disappear. Bow down your heads, please, everybody. Close your eyes. We are before the Lord. If for the first time you want to deal with the question of sin in your life, what if God, you are hearing us online and you are in the service, if God is using this virus to call the whole world back to himself, and here you are not yet prepared for the rapture, but you want to make that bold decision this morning, can I see your hand up? Can you put your hand to your chest, even if you are told, and you are hearing us, or you are in the service? Can you specifically tell Jesus about that sin that can send you to a Christless eternity? Say, Lord Jesus, I'm sorry for the way that I've lived. I come back to you today. I don't want to come today like I always come. But I come with a decision of mind to surrender my heart to you. I'm sorry for my sins. And I promise not to continue in them. Please, Lord Jesus, give me the power to go and see no more. Thank you, faithful Father. For that individual, put your hand to that chest area. I command, Lord, the release of your angels within 24 hours. Take away the reason for that emotional pain. If it is sickness, I curse that sickness. I curse that disease. If it is love, I ask that you'll be healed. I ask that God will take care of the reason for that emotional pain. And I, right now, as I speak, you pain in the chest, go.
Amen.
Put your hand to your forehead, everyone. You've got a destiny that you are trusting God for those 12 wells to manifest. If you are baptized in the Holy Spirit, pray in tongues for them. Just pray. And you are praying for your destiny to come forth with those 12 wells. Rabasanda Kayeborosu Takalia Yemoso Nalabashendehe. Thank you, faithful Father. I just agree together with you in faith now. Father, everyone that has asked me today, let their destiny come up with a well of purpose.
Amen.
Let your destiny come up with a well of God's peace.
Amen.
Let your destiny come up with the presence of God. Let your destiny begin to thrive with God's precious promises. Let your destiny not fail under prophetic covering and God's protection. Let your destiny be planted to experience pastoral care. Let your destiny be protected by the practice of faith. Let your destiny manifest and be glorious with the manifestations of purity of heart. Receive power to be holy. Let your destiny receive power to be holy. Let your life be free from sin. Let your destiny receive the well of God's power. Let your destiny receive the well of God's provision. Let your destiny receive the well of God's promotion. This week that promotion will come. Let your destiny never lack to praise God. Let God take away complaints, murmurings, and grumblings from your heart.
Amen.
May God give you a grateful heart.
Amen.
And may your destiny never remain the same again.
Amen.
Stretch forth your hands and pray for me. If I bless you, bless me. In Jesus' name we have prayed. If you are here to give your offering, you are free to do that. You can take the envelope. And the account number will be projected on the screen. Let's share the grace in fellowship. How many of you are blessed? Clap your hands and celebrate God. If you still want to wash your hands, you're free. If you want to not touch anybody, maybe. If you still need the sanitizer, but the Holy Ghost is here. Your life is preserved. If you are free, please join us in tidying up this place. Let's share the grace in fellowship. If you have the account number, if you want to do it, if you are here to do it, and you can get the envelope here. Let's share the grace in fellowship. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit forevermore. Amen. Look at somebody in the face and say, in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Your destiny will not remain the same again.
Your destiny will not remain the same.
Thank you very much for coming to church.
Amen.
Hello everyone. Thank you for listening to today's message. We hope you've been blessed. Please don't keep it to yourself. Share it with your contacts and don't forget to like and subscribe to this YouTube channel. Stay blessed.